Welcome back to Buckeye Bigfoot, and welcome to the 11th day of Squatchmas. Now, tonight's video has two different elements to it. The first part is the story, pretty much as you're expecting. Oh, then again, maybe the story isn't quite what you're expecting. I mean, do you ever really know what to expect on this channel? Well, the second part is, I guess you could say, it's really from tonight's target for Squatchmas cheer. But I better stop here. I don't want to give too many hints away. I mean, it is Christmas and all, and the suspense and guessing is half the fun, right? I just have to stop and not give too many hints. So be sure to pile up your snackage. You want it good and high tonight. I think it's time we get going on tonight's journey down into the snowy Sasquatch Valley. Hello to you, Nance, and to all the Sasquad. I wanted to share with you one of my best Christmas stories. There is a Sasquatch involved, I promise. Just be patient, please. I'm old now, and remembering is my favorite thing to do, especially at this time of year. I was raised on a farm north of Barberville in Kentucky. I haven't been back there in over 40 years now, not since we lost my dad, and my mom ended up moving up to Lexington to live with her sister, so she wouldn't be all alone. But it's on that farm where I came to know that there are indeed creatures you won't find in most books, and that most people do not believe exist. Christmas, 1963. Talk about a tumultuous time! As a nation, we were still reeling from the assassination of President Kennedy. I was an 11-year-old, and I was on the verge of having one of the most incredible Christmases of my life. I am, as I said, an old man now, and the joy and wonder of Christmas, that's hard for me to feel anymore. I don't think I've felt it the last 3 decades. But when I think back on this Christmas, I can almost feel the glow and warmth and the spread of extreme wonder that I experienced that year. And yes, also a little bit of terror. But I'm getting ahead. I'll try not to do that too much. Our farm was a typical working farm of that time in Kentucky. We had cattle for beef. We kept a Jersey for some milking, had a few Yorkshire pigs, chickens, and horses for riding. I do have a vague memory of us having some draft horses that were kept, but they were sold off when I was pretty young. Daddy got a tractor. He said no need for draft horses anymore. Well, he was wrong, of course, but that's not what this story is about. This story is about the only gift that I, along with my 14-year-old sister, Sarah, and our younger siblings aged 9, 5, and 2, we came together to give this gift as our parents that year. It started at Thanksgiving. We were waiting for my father to come back in from doing the morning chores. No one in our house ate breakfast until Papa came in. And somehow, Mama always had everything ready just to plate up the very second he walked in. Didn't matter if it was an hour after he went out or 3 hours after he went out. Usually, he did the morning chores in about 45 minutes, give or take. He and Mama got up at 4:30 every morning. She would boil the coffee while he washed his face, shaved, and got dressed. And no matter the weather, Papa went out to tend the animals, feed and water them all, clean what needed cleaned, and milk the Jersey. And as he said, whatever else he saw that needed doing. That morning, somehow the talk at the table came around to it being Thanksgiving, and why couldn't Daddy just take the day off? Now that little gem popped out of the mouth of Tilly, my 5-year-old sister. Me and my older sister Sarah, we knew the answer to that already. Papa was a farmer. There is no such thing as a day or even a morning off when you're a farmer with livestock. They must be seen to. Didn't matter the weather, how tired you were, or if you were deathly sick. You must see to those animals. They are your livelihood. I looked at Sarah, and she looked at me across the table. Somehow, between us, a plan began to form. Christmas Eve, I refused to go to sleep. I was afraid, you see. I was afraid I wouldn't get up. I did not have an alarm clock, and while we were used to waking early, none of us kids woke as early as our parents, and they had a wind-up alarm clock. I had never stayed up all night before in my life, and I did doze off, and I woke up with a jerk once, but I was relieved to see it was still dark out. I was already dressed when I heard the ringing of my parents' alarm clock down the hall. I got up, and I quickly got Sarah up, who had also fallen asleep. Sarah was grumpy and groggy at best in the mornings, but I reminded her it was Christmas, and this was something we had agreed to do. She got up. I heard Mama and Papa quietly talking as they often did in their bedroom early in the morning, and I saw the light under their door. Respectfully, I lightly tapped on their bedroom door. Papa jerked open the door quickly, alarmed that we were already awake. "What's wrong?" he asked quickly before the door was even all the way open. "Nothing, sir," I said. "You and Mama can take the morning off, sir. Me and Sarah will do all the morning chores. I'm going to do yours, and Sarah's going to take over from Mama. Merry Christmas." We stood there, nervously waiting for a reaction. You could have heard a pin drop on the wood of that hallway floor. It was a long 2 seconds waiting. Behind him, I heard Mama softly say, "Will, what is it?" Mama was wrapping herself up in a robe. We rarely, if ever, saw our parents in any state other than fully dressed. This was not the kind of house where Mama cooked breakfast in her gown and robe. No, sir. They were of the older generation, and they did not leave the bedroom in any state of undress, as they called it, unless it was an emergency. And to them, nightgown and pajamas, that was a state of undress. Papa looked at me. "You sure, son? It's awful cold out." I swallowed hard. I knew I was taking on a big responsibility that morning. I didn't know if he would trust me enough. My papa was a very particular man, especially about the care of his livestock. That, again, was his livelihood. It would be like giving all your cash to someone just to hold on to. You really have to trust them. But I had went around with him many mornings over the last several years, and I had been paying special attention and asked a lot of questions at different times in the last month since Thanksgiving. "Yes, sir," I said. "I'm sure of it." Then Sarah piped up, and she told Mama that she would get breakfast started for her. I know that in today's glitzy age of mega Christmas gifts with shiny paper and bells on the doors and metallic bows, electronic everything, I know this simple doing of chores probably seems like a stupid gift or insignificant at the least. How boring, I'm sure you're thinking. But it was the best that we could give. We children had no money, and even if we had no way to get to town to get our parents anything. Sure, we cut out paper ornaments, and we made paper cards and things like that. But we wanted to give them a real gift. And a morning off from chores, it was the downright best thing we could think of. After another second, Papa nodded his head at us slowly. That was his way of saying, "All right, then, go on." I heard Mama again. She was still sitting on the side of the bed. She looked a little panic-stricken. "Will?" she said again, uncertainty and fear clear in her voice. "Everything's okay, Rosie." I heard Papa say that as he closed the door. Sarah and I went right to it. I first went out and I topped up all the firewood in the house. I brought everything in I thought would be needed for the day. Now, Mama had just gotten an electric stove 2 years before, but we still had wood stoves in the house for heat and a fireplace. Then I bundled up again and began the walk out to the animals. I remember that there was still snow on the ground. It was not freshly fallen snow, mind you. I think it had fallen a day or two before, as I recall. But I do remember it was white and bright out there, even at 5 a.m. in the darkness of pre-dawn. It was below freezing, too. I remember because the pig's water was frozen solid. I had to get all that changed out, too. In the meantime, I was out there talking to the pigs. I checked each one out, just like Daddy did. I fed them. I then tended to the horses. Then it was time for the Jersey cow. And I did get her milked, but not nearly as expertly or as quickly as Papa. And I got it done with only a minimal amount of waste, though it took longer for me to move the pails. I was not as fast or strong as Papa at only 11 years old. Everything I did that morning took twice as long as it took Papa. I did hope that Sarah was having better timing making breakfast than I had with the animals. By the time I entered the cattle barn, the cows were very restless and making a lot of noise. I assumed it was because I was running late according to the universal cow clock. But no, they were really acting strange. Normally, the cattle would line up at the front of the left and the right pens with their heads sticking through the gates, waiting for the hay and silage. This morning, they were kicking up a loud fuss all right, but they were hanging back. Along the right side of the barn, the cows in that pen seemed agitated, but they were still milling around. But when I glanced over to the left side pen, I saw that most of the cattle were crunched down at the end, nearest to the doors that I had just used to come into the barn. They were all at one end, and they were kicking up a very large fuss. Nervous about doing all of this on my own for the first time, I put it all down to running late, and they were probably just hungry. So I set to work filling the wheelbarrow with hay and began forking it into the feed troughs. Through their bellowing and mooing, I'm talking to the cattle, just as my papa always did. You know, somehow, he had this magical way of calming them down right away. All he had to do was talk to them. But it seemed I did not have that power. As the cows remained agitated as I filled the troughs, first the right pen, then the left, then working my way down the middle of the barn between the two, I noticed that the cattle in the right pen came a few at a time out to feed from the trough, but half at any time were still hanging back. The left pen of cattle? They would not come forward to feed. They stayed huddled, backed up against that wall. I tried talking to them. I coaxed them. Nothing worked. I jumped out of my skin when I heard a creak and a bang of the barn door. I jumped, and I looked toward the barn doors that faced the house, the ones I had just come in through. They were still closed. I just was sure my daddy didn't trust me, and he was out there to tell me to go back inside. Then I looked down to the other doors that led out to the pasture. I then saw that one door was moving and bouncing just a little bit with the wind outside. I walked down to the end of the barn, surprised that Daddy hadn't latched it well last night. Then I saw that the doors were not firmly pulled shut at all. Without thinking any more, I pulled them too. That was when I saw that the bar latch on the inside of the barn door was broken. Something had pulled hard enough to snap the wood bar. Now this bar was only about 10 inches long. It was maybe half an inch thick. This was not a lock. Think of it as like a gate latch. You could open it from the inside or the outside of the barn. I made a note in my head to tell Papa. Then I thought, maybe I could fix it. Maybe I could surprise him. But I didn't have the first clue of what to do or how to do it to fix something like that. So I pulled the doors together as best I could, then went back to the wheelbarrow halfway down the barn full of hay and I began forking it into the remaining troughs and adding the silage like Papa did. On the right side, a few brave cows were coming forward and kept putting their heads through the pen gates to eat, and only the ones near the front barn doors. None of the cattle in the left pen, however, would come forward for food. Something was wrong with them. I stood there, in my mind going over all the things that I might have done wrong. Now, any adult by this time would have already begun to look around, thinking that something is there spooking the cows. I just didn't have that experience. I had never known a reason for anything to be spooked on our farm by anything else, other than a snake, and it was too cold for that in December. At some point, it dawned on me that maybe something had gotten into the barn. I didn't know what, though. I thought about that busted door. Now, even as a kid, I had heard some awful stories from older people about things that had happened long ago and things that happened during the Depression. One old woman we knew from down the road, I once overheard her telling everyone about the time she went into the barn in the 1930s, and she found two men in the barn, and they were up to no good. She said if her brothers hadn't been outside and heard her screaming, well, she didn't know what would have happened. I also knew that people got into the barns to hide. I'd heard about it, like bank robbers and other criminals. Didn't they always search barns for those kinds of people? I was 11 years old, so all of that seemed very plausible. I suddenly got scared, but I was trying to not act scared. And of all the mornings that I'd decided to do this on my own, I thought, I know Papa would not have been scared. My papa was a World War II veteran, and he'd served in the Navy in the Pacific aboard the USS Enterprise, CV-6. That's right, the USS Enterprise. Not Star Trek's Enterprise for you younger people listening. No, my papa thought Bull Halsey walked on water. I wasn't quite sure at that time who Bull Halsey was exactly, but I knew, according to my papa, he ranked right up there with Jesus Christ. So, next to Papa, I was nothing. That's how I was feeling at that moment. I was scared. I didn't know what to do. And I knew my daddy wouldn't have been scared, and he would have known what to do. So, metaphorically speaking, those boots I was trying to wear that morning, my Papa's boots, they were suddenly gargantuan. And I never felt it more when a figure suddenly loomed tall out of the darkness at the pasture end of the barn. Turning my head slowly like in some horror film, I saw what I did not want to see, like something out of a horror film. It was every child's nightmare, a real, living, breathing, I assumed, monster stepping out of the dark shadows. I would like to say I suddenly bolted for the door and ran screaming all the way to the house, but that would be a lie. I was rooted to that spot like a 200-year-old oak tree. The cows really started mooing, and they were pushing back on each other as this large monster began to walk steadily down the length of the left pen. I stood there with a fork full of hay, not knowing what to do. It didn't matter, because I couldn't do anything. Every muscle in my body felt pulled so tight, I started shaking. I remember hay shaking off the pitchfork in my hands. From the darkness of the barn, this monster, as I had come to think of it, this monster walked forward and stopped before it came directly under one of the hanging bulbs in the barn. Its eyes were darker than the shadow that the hanging bulb threw on its face. I was sure I was going to die, right there in the barn on Christmas morning. I did try to yell, but my throat was so tight I think I barely squeaked. But the monster heard it. It rumbled a reply right back from its throat. I don't know how long we stood there looking at each other. From my 11-year-old perspective, this monster was King Kong right there in the flesh. The overhead bulb and its metal apron did little more than cast shadows making the monster seem even scarier. Thinking back on it, I believe it was trying to decide what to do with me or about me. Perhaps it took the pitchfork in my hands as some kind of weapon, which it could have been, I suppose, only as 11-year-old, I didn't have the strength or skill to fight with a pitchfork. Its shoulders were as wide as any cow's backside. If you took a man and you put one of those old-style leather football helmets on it, but put a little more peak to the shape, that's what its head looked like to me. Its head was wide, as were its shoulders. There was too much shadow for me to see the face clearly, but its entire body faced me, and even from the shadows, I knew its eyes were on me. Does it really make a difference if the fur was black or brown? Because I don't know. It could have been either. There in the barn on that cold and dark Christmas morning, black or brown fur? Well, wasn't what I was wondering about. I was wondering if I was about to die. I registered the sound of a barn door coming open, but I suppose my mind either couldn't process it or passed it off because I thought it was the loose door down on the pasture end. But no, it was Papa. He knew I'd been gone too long out there. Later, I would learn that he had been pacing in the kitchen, looking out the window toward the barn. My mother kept telling him to sit down and have some coffee. But he was pacing, torn between wanting to show me that he trusted me and worry that something had happened to me, like maybe I'd taken a kick from one of the horses or slipped on manure and fell right onto a pitchfork. You know, that actually happened to the son of one of the men that my father knew. My sister Sarah is the one who told me later all the things he was worried about as he paced. He wanted to let me know that he had absolute trust in me to take care of the animals, and he realized I was trying to give him a gift. Sarah said she heard him tell Mama all of this as he paced back and forth. But when they began to hear the cows making their unusual bellows, he knew something was wrong. And in seconds, he had his boots on and his coat, and he was out the back door and jogging quickly up the path to the barn. You know, I thank the good Lord for my Papa for lots of different reasons, but never more than on that Christmas morning. You see, he didn't curse, and he believed curse words were reserved for what he called the lower class. I never thought to ask him exactly what we were, as we weren't exactly loaded with money, nor were we going to any high society functions. But I never did ask him. The thing is, I do believe I heard him say or use or refer to that monster's presence in the barn with a set of particularly vile curse words that he learned in his naval days. Funny I still remember that. I only knew my father was there for sure when I felt the pitchfork pulled from my hands and I looked up and I saw him. The pitchfork left my hands and then everything was blocked by the drab olive green of his coat as he came to stand in front of me. "Go, Billy, go, run to the house," my father said. He was yelling at me as he pushed and walked me backwards. I did not want to leave my father to face that monster alone, but I didn't know what else to do, and all my life I had been obedient to my father. And now that the spell was broken, and now that I was able to move, I did as my father bid me to do. I ran on shaky legs right back to the house. Halfway, I looked back, and I saw that my father was running down the path toward me, and I was relieved. He was running with the pitchfork in his hand. We stormed through the back door into the kitchen, and it was all a flurry. Mama and Sarah held our younger siblings back. Papa told all of us to stay inside. All the while, Mama kept saying, "Will, what is it? What is it? What's wrong? What's happened?" Papa gave her a look that is only known between husbands and wives. You know, those looks you give each other when you don't want to say something in front of the kids. Mama immediately fell silent. Papa ran for his shotgun, and he told us all to stay in the house. The kitchen door closed after him, and I stood there just shaking. Mama took me by the shoulders and whirled me around. She got in my face and asked me what had happened. I couldn't answer her. I started crying. I tried so hard to tell her about the monster, but all that came out were strangled cries. We all moved to the window that faced the barn from the kitchen to watch and to wait. Mama asked me again and again what was going on. I heard the fear and panic in her voice. I had started to calm down enough. I said, "There's a monster with the cows." "A monster?" she said. "What do you mean? What kind of monster? Don't you be telling me no tales, Billy boy." Now, strangely enough, I somehow understood she was hoping I was telling her a tall tale. I didn't get a chance to say anything else, though. A shotgun blast came from the barn. We heard a loud roar. A second and a half later, there came another blast. We all were holding our breath, and we looked at each other with wide eyes. Bobby, the little 2-year-old, began crying. He did not understand what was happening, and he must have been very scared. Then Mama ran to the bedroom, then ran back to the peg coat rack hanging by the door, and she started to put on her coat. She looked at us and she said, "You kids stay here. If I don't come back, you go over to Mr. Ripley's and you get him. You hear me?" We said yes. Mr. Ripley was our neighbor. If we went out on the front porch, and if we leaned out real far, and if we squinted our eyes, we could look down the road and see just the edge of Mr. Ripley's porch, about a quarter mile down the road, just as the road curved. As Mama headed out the door, I saw that she had slipped Papa's revolver into her coat pocket. That's what she had went to the bedroom for. Just as Mama's hand was on the door and opening it, Sarah said, "It's Papa. He's coming back." I have never known such relief in my life. Papa won. He beat the monster. Papa's okay. During that day, there was a flurry of activity, as you would not believe, at our house. We did not have a phone, so Daddy drove in to Barberville to get some of the men that he knew, which was no easy thing to do on Christmas Day. Mr. Ripley, by the way, had heard the shotgun, and he came down to see what was wrong. He stayed with us until Papa got back with some men. The men came, and they searched. Some of them brought dogs, and they all saw blood in the snow. Strangely, the dogs did not want to track like usual. Daddy said it looked like the monster had been sleeping on that end of the barn, probably just for that night. The monster, however, was never seen again. I never got the full story of that whole day until I was a lot older, and I still cannot say with certainty that I got all of the story. When Papa went back into that barn, the monster was still there. He yelled at it, and he told it to get out. He said it stared at him, and it growled. He said he really did not want to shoot it. He walked down the center between the pens, and all the while the monster turned to watch him. He pushed open the pasture doors. He told it again to get out. The cows saw that pasture gate open, and normally they went out their own chutes from the ends of each side of the barn rather than down the middle. But there were pen gates that faced the middle of the barn. Staying close to the right side pen and keeping his eyes on the monster, Papa walked backwards to open the right pen gate. At the first chance, those cows stampeded to get the heck out of the barn. The cows in the left pen were still huddled as far as they could stay away from the monster. But when Papa opened their gate, at first they didn't want to go, but as soon as one braved it, they also stampeded out of there. All the time, he and the monster were looking at each other. Now the cattle barn was empty, It was just him and that monster. Papa waved his arms again, and he told it to get out of his barn. I once asked Papa why he didn't just shoot it. He said he wasn't really sure. It just felt wrong when he looked at it. Now that coming from a man who not only fought in World War II, but had no problem helping slaughter animals or take down an animal when hunting, well, I guess that says something, doesn't it? He kept waving his arms and yelling. He said the monster did not like that. It walked back to the corner that it had come from, and to my father's surprise, a huge, heavy mallet hammer came flying right at him, and if he hadn't bent sideways, it would have hit him right in the head. That hammer had gone missing a few weeks before. We don't know. Did the monster take it weeks before, or had it just found it that night? Had Papa left it inside that cattle pen for some reason? When we talked about this when I was older, I asked him these questions. He said he did not believe he left it in that cattle pen. He had no reason to use it there. He was certain the very last thing he used that mallet hammer for was to reseal some barrels that Mama had been storing pork layers in. That was near the pantry room off the back porch. When that hammer came flying, Papa fired that first blast into the far end of the barn. The monster roared terribly. Papa then fired his second shell into the dark corner. He broke the shotgun open and was pulling shells out of his coat pocket to reload when the monster climbed over the pen fence and went out the open pasture doors. As he snapped, the double barrel closed. He saw the very last of that monster's backside as it left the barn. As for the rest of that day, you already know. I've told you. They searched, and it was not seen again. I tell you with God as my witness, this is all true. I have nothing to gain and a lot to lose, even at this stage of life, by telling this. In the late 1970s, my father did see the Patterson-Gimlin film on television. So did I. We were both struck by it. Now we had a name for our monster other than just Wood Booger or Monster. Despite all the scary things of that Christmas morning, you might be surprised to know that I still think of that Christmas as one of the most important and most beloved Christmases in my life. I think about it every Christmas. You know, it was such a strange time for me. And wonderful, if sad, and scary. The country was still mourning a president, as I said. I was in that strange twilight age. I was no longer exactly a child, but I was not yet an adult, or even a teen. I was proud of the gift that I had tried so hard to give my father, even if it all went wrong. I still think of that cold morning every Christmas. It was a morning of transformation for me in more ways than I have time to tell you. So many things are wrapped up in that for me. I know, lots of you were probably impatient. You just wanted to get to the monster or the Sasquatch part. But I just couldn't tell you only the monster part of it. It would be like giving someone just one piece of a puzzle. Then again, maybe it's just me being old and I'm missing my parents and my sister Sarah, who is also now gone. I miss them all more and more every year. You know, I worked hard all my life. I went to college and I earned some pretty impressive degrees. I never married and I never had children. So all the wealth I've gathered in my life is, well, let's just say, not a small amount. But I would give every penny, cash in every bond, sell every rental property I have, and liquidate everything else I could, just for once, just to walk up to that simple farmhouse again, the one with just a pine wreath for the outside decoration, and inside, just a sparse tree standing with some paper ornaments on it, maybe to sing some carols with my sisters and my brother, and then to sit down at that modest, beat-up wood table for a Christmas dinner with my parents and one of their home-smoked hams. Yes, I would trade it all in. So Merry Christmas, Nance, and to all my fellow Sasquad. I hope you have enjoyed this. Signed, Billy Boy. All right, now before I tell you who tonight's target is, I'm going to give you a little taste of what they have to offer. A while back, this person gave me permission to read their reports on this channel, so here are two samples. Listen and see what you think. You ready? Here we go. In the mid-1950s, Richard was bow deer hunting in the swamp to the east of Sidtown Road, which leads to Cook Dam along the River Road, about 5 miles to Oscoda, Michigan. He was about one-third of the way on the road to the dam. The Wildcat Swamp is very dense cedar swamp, with a meandering creek that can flow either way. Richard says that compasses nor GPS work well in that area. The swamp's northern border is the Osable River, which is very crooked. According to the aerial photo, the swamp is likely 4 miles east and west by 3 miles north and south. As Richard was being very quiet as he hunted for deer with his recurved bow, he apparently got within 10 yards of a Bigfoot-type creature that suddenly stood up and ran away to the north on 2 feet. It was likely 8 to 9 feet tall and 3 to 4 feet wide and dark black in color. He did not get a good look at its face as it ran away, but its shoulders moved greatly as it moved through the swamp. Richard said that it went right through the dense swamp, crashing and breaking everything in its path, including knocking over a 4 to 5 inch thick cedar tree whose roots came right out of the ground. It made a very loud noise as it went, and he was petrified, seeing what he saw, and he immediately retreated back to his vehicle. He said, "It was much too big for a bear, of which he has hunted extensively," and he said that they will usually stand and face an intruder momentarily before retreating, and always on 4 feet. He only mentioned his sighting to a couple of friends and family, and they all said, of course, he saw a bear. Richard says that he has encountered several bear in his many years of hunting, and they have often stood up and threatened him, so they're obviously a bear. Later that same year, he and about 4 other fellows, including Ed, Eddie, Todd, and Jerry, they were roasting a pig over the fire at the old sportsman club that overlooked the Osable River. The club is no longer there. They were there with the Department of Natural Resources, planning a safety program. It was late at night, 2:30 to 3 a.m. Suddenly, from maybe a couple miles away, they all heard moose-like growls that went on for a while, 3 different times and about 45 seconds apart. The last one was shorter. They looked at each other, wondering what it was. They concluded that it was probably a moose, but have never been moose reported in that area. He knew that it was a Bigfoot, but that he would be ridiculed if he mentioned it, so he didn't say anything. This is Joe's Bigfoot encounter near Gladwin, Michigan. In the spring of 2002, Joe was turkey hunting on a rented 40 acres about 5 miles north of Gladwin. On the way into his blind, he found 5 to 6 trees broken and twisted branches 4 feet long, all laid out perpendicularly across the trail that he normally used. They were 1/2 inch to 1 inch in diameter, but it didn't register what they might be. He could not see where a windstorm could have done that, as the rest of the tree butts were not there. On November 15, 2002, deer season opened. He went to his deer blind, which was a plywood structure. Although his ears are not good in the dark, he heard something come walking right up to the back of his blind, stopping only a few feet away. He knew it was big and heavy, and it upset him so much he was sweating heavily. He considered that the Amish might be doing it, but they would have been doing chores at that time of day. He clicked his gun's safety off, and whatever it was, turned and walked away. He never saw any deer that day, which was quite unusual, as he usually got his deer on opening day. No smell was apparent. On the next day, he got to the blind about 4 p.m. He fell asleep, but when he woke up, he saw a long, hairy arm reach from behind a pine tree near his bait pile. It reached over the bait pile. He saw up to the base of the neck, but the neck was the size of a man's leg. He could not see the body. The hair was 6 to 8 inches long. It was orange to gray to white at the tip. It was approximately 25 to 30 yards away. He only saw 4 deer that year, which, again, was unusual. He did see one deer run by that had its mouth open from running hard. That area is near a creek, and his brothers have commented that they have smelled something very bad several times there. In 1996, he was shining deer in October, and he saw 2 Bigfoots in a field. They stood there as he spotlighted them. Their eyes glowed red, and the larger must have been at least 1,000 pounds. With many deer in the area, he felt he better leave. He reported that sighting to the BFRO. He and his wife lived off the main road, about a quarter mile in a mobile home. On several occasions, his wife had something on 2 feet walking around the house, so they bought 3 dogs for protection. One time, something hit the house so hard, it rattled the dishes in the cupboards. It was near Albright Shores, about 1 mile from the Tittabawassee River. It put a big dent 8 feet high on the siding, and a 1-inch groove in the siding as well. Of course, they were still thinking it was the neighbors. Several times his wife would hear sticks breaking in the woods, 50 yards away. One time they sent the big dog Willie out, but he came back in seconds, shaking, and pushed his wife right back into the house. He then showed his wife how to use the shotgun. A co-worker, 2 or 3 miles away, reported that a door was ripped off an old barn, so they parked an old Dodge Omni by the door. But the next time they visited the barn, they saw that the car was flipped over on its top, and the barn door was again ripped off. His grandfather was a great hunter, and one time he was driving on M61 and reported a 4-foot-tall animal with red eyes standing in the middle of the road, with 2 cars barely missing it. He thought that it was a bear, but bears don't have red eyes and shine in the dark. In about 1966 at the old house, his uncle found bear feet tracks in the drive, but would not admit it. All right, my Sasquatch. Now, those last 2 were samples of the kinds of reports that are taken and compiled by tonight's target for Squatchmas cheer. I almost said Christmas. For Squatchmas cheer. And the target is Phil Shaw from West Branch, Michigan. Now, Phil has put in a tremendous amount of work compiling Bigfoot sightings and experiences all around Michigan. I personally love to read Phil's reports. They're written in a very concise manner. If you're a fan of more of the just the facts, ma'am, kind of Bigfoot reporting without all the story narrative, you definitely want to be on Phil's channel. Now, Phil doesn't actually read the reports word for word like I do, but he goes over them and he talks about them and he puts the typed reports up there on the channel screen so you can read them. So go on, head on over to Phil's page, show him a little bit of deranged elf love. Go ahead, run amok, run amok, run amok. I'm going to put a link to his channel in the video description below. And at the end of this video, I will put up the links to his channel and to his latest video, which as you can see right here on the screen, I've already hit that up with a Merry Squatchmas. Now, if you want to go look for Phil Shaw, you're going to look for PHILONEWS1. So that's Phil O News 1, all one word. All right, well, listen. Target acquired, my deranged elves. Go run amok and spread your particular brand of mischievous cheer. Because we only have tonight and tomorrow night left to do this in. Well, all righty. That's it. We have come to the end of the 11th day of Squatchmas. Can you believe it? Wow. 1 day left. So be sure to tune in tomorrow night at 7 p.m. Eastern Time. And until then, always remember, absence of proof is not proof of absence. And double buttercream on those cookies, folks. All right, everyone. Thanks for listening.